mathematics, the science, the history curriculum, and work out how can you find some major emotional impact in whatever it is you want to teach. And you can only do that by fitting it into a story form. Now, give an example or two of how we can do that. But the story remains crucial, not just for human beings in general, making sense of their lives, but particularly for the way we organize anything we want to teach to students. Now, if you look at the kinds of stories that very young children are most readily engaged by, find most interesting, they're things like the Grimm fairy stories, for example, for young children. And you can notice a few things about them. The first is, as it says here, that they're built on binary opposites. So all the Grimm fairy stories are built on things that are both like courage and cowardice, security and fear, good and evil, etc. So there's a sense in which the stories are meditations on those binary opposites and how they function. Good and bad, courage, cowardice, security, fear, etc., etc., and they go on forever. Now, what the binary opposite does is give you a first grappling point on the world, something that grasps the content for you. By putting it into opposites, there's a way of giving you a kind of first hold on what this content is like and how you can then make sense of it. The other thing you could notice about these binary opposites is that they're immensely abstract. So children of ages 4 or 5 are using, all the time, the most abstract ideas human beings ever learn. Now, some of the strange folklore one reads in education is that young children are supposed to be concrete thinkers, whatever that means. Which doesn't make a great deal of sense if you see that in even the fairy stories that most engage them, they're built on these powerful, abstract binary opposites. And if they didn't grasp those abstract ideas, of course the story would make no sense. So you see children using and meditating on, through the stories, these abstract binary opposites like courage, cowardice, etc., constantly. The other thing you can notice about these abstract binary opposites is that they're affective. That is, they're emotionally charged. So they're not, courage and cowardice are not simply logical opposites, they're emotionally powerful opposites that we deal with. So all of the content of the stories of young children are of that kind. They're powerful, abstract, affective, binary opposites. And you might say that if you want any concrete content to make sense to children in classrooms, you should build it, this is for young children, you need to build it on these kinds of underlying abstract binary opposites. Let me give you an example. Another feature of the kinds of books I read in education is that they suggest that children learn about the world by starting with what's local and around them and gradually working up from there. And you have to ask, if that's the case, why are children so interested in things like talking little class rabbits? Yeah, as in Peter Rabbit, or talking worms, or whatever it might be. I haven't been in Santiago long enough, but where I come from, there just aren't any talking little class rabbits wandering around. So you have to wonder, why are they so important to children? Especially if they're supposed to be only interested in the concrete, practical world around them. So where do they come from? Here's one kind of explanation. Okay. Because we know these things fill all the fantasy stories of children, which children love, but also they fill the myth stories of the world. So these are not trivial, casual things. If every myth corpus, every myth stories, and every child's story has these kinds of creatures in that are half human, half animal, etc. You have to wonder what the hell's going on. So, If you think about how we learn about the physical world around us, we start by noticing in terms of temperature, for example, you learn hot, cold first. That's hot. That's cold. This is hot, that's cold. What the binary opposites do is set up a continuum for you, and these are the extremes of the continuum. They're the binary, the opposite forms. What you then do is mediate between the two. So you can develop from hot and cold, you can develop a concept like warm. So warm is both hot and cold mixed together. Now, when you're 4 or 5 years old, you notice and you learn that everything in the world is not made up of these continua, like from hot to cold, from big, big to little, from hard to soft, etc., etc. But there are things like life and death. Life and death are opposites as well, in some form. So what do you do when you try to mediate, when you use the tool of forming binary opposites and mediating that is so useful in making sense of the physical world? What happens when you apply that to life and death? Well, you generate new categories like ghosts. You create creatures that are both alive and dead. In the same way that warm is hot and cold, a ghost is both alive and dead in some way. And we have all, vampires and living and walking dead, all the modern crazed zombie movies are mediators between life and death, because there are ways in which we think about what these categories mean, and they enrich and make more complex the understanding we have of these categories. We also notice, a young child will notice by age 4 or 5, that there's a difference between human beings and animals. All cultures distinguish between human and animal. Some cultures distinguish differently from others, but they all make crucial distinctions between the human and animal. So what do you get when you mediate between humans and animals? Well, you get things like yetis, Sasquatches, mermaids, and I've forgotten the name of the... these creatures remain fascinating. If you open the newspaper tomorrow and saw a story about, some feature of Chilean politics and the other, a sighting of a chalco. Which do you read first? These things, even though we know they don't exist, they remain fascinating because they are the mediators that have been generated from these opposites. So it's a function of the way our language and our minds make sense of the world by grasping opposites and then mediating. And one of the more basic for a young child, of course, is the difference between nature and culture. They recognize immediately the difference between things that are natural and things that have been transformed for human purposes. We can see virtually nothing except faces in this room that are natural. And even our faces are like, But what do you get when you mediate between nature and culture? Well, we get things like talking little plant rabbits, for example. That is, things that embody both a natural component and a cultural component. And these remain fascinating. I think I was yesterday using the example of Star Trek, these science fiction movies. In most cases, the most interesting character is the robot, because the robot embodies a combination between the natural and the cultural. And indeed, the living and the dead, etc. So, a central component of making things interesting and meaningful to children is to find, in whatever topic you want to teach, the fundamental binary opposites, and then looking for mediations and then elaborations. Because you can't do the elaboration until you've got fixed the opposites that will give the child some way of grasping that content. And we do it initially, usually, by forming binary opposites. Now another thing that comes along with oral language, is the ability to form images in your mind from words. So if I was to tell you about the teacher in, well, make it Vancouver rather than Santiago, just be deeply exciting. So the teacher in Vancouver has been working all day, is very tired, she's driving home on the highway, the sun is blinding her, she's getting up late, but she knows that when she gets home, she can go to the back of the garden where there is a Japanese garden, Japanese style garden. There's a pond, there's a stone wall around a moss garden, and there's a tea house, an ochre, yellow ochre tea house. And she knows that she can take out a cup of tea, sit on a chair, put her feet up on the stone wall, and she notices that on today, three new red water lilies have opened on the pond. And the goldfish are swimming around happily as usual. Now, what I've done is suck in air and let it out gradually over the larynx and the pharynx and shake it with the tongue into these peculiar sounds. And what has happened is that it has generated images in your mind. I hope. That's it. If you're still not dreaming about what you're going to do with that lottery ticket. And this is very peculiar. Breathing in air and creating images in other people's minds. And the images that we form are things that we can't fail to form. That is, you have... Now, everybody in the room will have a different image of the Japanese garden and the woman and the rest of it. But you can't fail to generate an image of some kind while you listen to something like that. Even if it's the most fleeting image, you know, the four water, the three water lilies that have opened, the red water lilies, the colour of the tea house, what that looks like, the moss garden, which is green, and the grey stone wall. So that, you know, these things happen, or indeed, driving on the highway with the sun. So that we are constantly making images, and often we do it so efficiently and rapidly that we hardly notice it. We just take it for granted as a part of our thinking. And you have to realize, of course, every child in every classroom, every day, is forming images constantly. Or not, because one of the key tools we have for communicating meaning is the generation of these kinds of images that we form in our minds. Every content that you teach in every curriculum area, every day, has as a part of it some powerful images that you can use to carry the meaning to the minds of the students in a vivid way. Most of the textbooks I read in education go on and on endlessly about the concepts that you might teach and the content that you teach, but hardly ever do I see anything about the images that you can locate in those concepts and that content that will carry that meaning powerfully to the student's mind. So part of the task of teaching anything is to locate within it what are the best, the most powerful images. It doesn't matter too much which you choose, but as long as they then carry to the student's mind something about meaning, because it will engage the student's imaginations and the content that you're dealing with. They won't simply learn the text, as it were. They will feel something about it, because our images, the images we form from words, always carries a feeling, some emotion there, however fleeting and however brief. Another tool that comes along with an oral language is a sense of mystery and wonder. And I illustrated briefly with a series of letters that were exchanged between Isaac Newton, the great physicist and nutcase, oh, no, I mean, a fine person, Newton was a very strange man, because everybody who met Newton felt as though they wanted to go and lie down afterwards, because he was so clever. And he invented so many things and was so brilliant. Locke taught about the incomparable Mr. Newton. Nobody had ever met anybody like him. When he was an older man, his nephew wrote to him one time and said, "Gosh, Uncle Ike, or
Ike,
Uncle, you are one of the cleverest people in the world anybody's ever known, and you've invented the calculus and the laws of motion and the analysis of light, one thing after another." And he said, "It's amazing, you are so astonishing," etc., etc., boring me on. And Newton, in reply, quite famously, wrote a letter back and said, "Well, it may seem so to you, but to myself, I feel like a boy on the seashore who's been attracted by a prettier stone or a smoother shell, when all the time before me the great ocean of knowledge that existed, and I haven't even noticed it." So what he expresses is a sense that the world is so amazing and wonderful, and we know so pitifully little about it. Now, either this can depress you out of your mind, or it can give one a sense that that the world is wonderful and to be explored, and that exploration is a fantastic adventure. So the way Newton then represents the world for his nephew is rather different, you may have noticed, from the way we represent to children in textbooks the world. We represent the world to children as known, and the textbooks get bigger every year, so we know all about mathematics. You start with grade 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, each year you get a bigger and bigger math book, and the same with history, we know all the history. You know. So the child's view when they start school is that everything is known, and their job is to learn it bit by bit. How boring can that be, you know? Why bother? You'd be dead soon, you know. Whereas instead, if we think of the world as a great adventure to be explored, and that what we actually know is pitifully little about the world, then the child becomes engaged in the same adventure that we all are engaged in exploring the world, finding out new things. And indeed, it's very useful to say, "Well, we're going to explore some concepts in geometry today, and we don't know a lot about geometry, but this is the kind of thing we know, and this leads us to other things." So you get a sense of they become participants in an adventure of exploration. Now, that can seem a little bit overwrought, a bit too romantic maybe, because day by day it's hard to keep that up. But it's an attitude to what the enterprise is about that I think can shift for us a little bit our sense of what we're doing day by day and how we might go about doing it. So, most of you, who are teachers, will have gone through programs that will have given you an introduction to planning teaching that ask you to begin by stating your objectives and then deciding on the content that you're going to teach, and then the methods that you will use to teach that content, and then to have an evaluation procedure at the end. Is that familiar? That's a good way of boring children out of their minds. This is a procedure that as far as I'm aware is available in every country in the world now uses this planning procedures. And they came, as you may not know, or maybe you do know, but they came from how to build refrigerators and motor cars on assembly lines in America in the 1920s. So if you're building a motor car, you first design it in great detail, that's your objective. You then get the materials that you need for the seats and the bits and pieces, the engine and all the rest of it, and the wheels, that's for your content. And then you need the skills to put them together, so you need to have the methods you will get on the assembly line to put the car together. And then at the end, in industry, you would have the quality control to make sure that everything works. Okay. So, so what we have done in education is take from an industrial model a method for building refrigerators and motorcars, and thought, oh, why don't we apply this to children? Obvious. Obviously stupid, right? So what we've been trying to do instead is look at ways in which we can take some of the kinds of toolkits that I've been talking about, the first one, and build different kinds of planning frameworks so that we could think of teaching as telling a good story about the content rather than, as it were, building a refrigerator. This leads to a different way of thinking about the task at hand. I won't go through these. We have a website, and you can see lots of examples. I'll just quickly do one example.